This is part two in the series of orals preparation. I will provide you with part one of the orals preparation series in the description section below. The whole idea of making this video is to prepare the deck cadets appearing for the third mate or second mate orals. It's difficult for me to cover the entire oral syllabus in one video, so I'm breaking it up into a series of videos which should not be about more than over 15 to 20 minutes long. So I'm taking up five questions at a time in a video, and I'll talk about those questions because I need some time to talk about each question and how to prepare the answer for if such a question is asked to the officers. I look forward to your feedback. I've been getting a lot of feedback from you, and I appreciate it. A lot of you have been asking me to cover different topics. It takes me time to prepare the videos, so please stay patient, and I'll try to cover or include all the topics that have been suggested by you guys. So I'll start with this video here. This is part two of orals preparation for deck cadets appearing for third mate and second mate. So let's start with the first question in this series. So the question is, what are the duties of the officer on watch when in pilotage waters with the pilot on board? The answer is that the officer on watch remains the master's representative in the absence of the master, despite the presence of the pilot. So when the pilot is on board, the pilot is the local expert and he's leading your ship or navigating your ship into the berth. But at the end of the day, the master remains the overall command, and you, as the master's representative, become the in charge if the master is not there, even though the pilot might be on board. The exception is, of course, the exceptions of Panama Canal and Suez Canal, where the pilot assumes the overall control of the vessel due to the special circumstances, as I'm sure you guys are familiar with. During any pilotage period, the officer on watch would be expected to maintain an effective lookout at all times. In addition, he or she would continually monitor the ship's position by primary and secondary means and ensure that the under-keel clearance is adequate throughout. The ship should always be navigating safely, keep a lookout, inform the pilot and the master of any dangers to navigation. That may be an oncoming ship, it could be a low under-keel clearance. Never assume that they're aware of it. Make sure that you do your job by informing the master and the pilot. The officer on watch duties also include the management of the bridge personnel and ensuring that the pilot's instructions are executed in the correct manner by the members of the bridge team. Example being, if there's a helmsman who's steering, then make sure that the helmsman follows the pilot's orders and is executing those orders correctly. If there's a lookout, the lookout should have been following the instructions of the pilot and the master, especially in circumstances. The officer on watch should also further ensure that the pilot is made familiar with the bridge instrumentation and advised of any compass errors or any malfunctioning or defects of the navigation equipment, which may affect the safe navigation of the vessel. So it's normally these days, you are not normally these days, but of course you have an ISM checklist these days. When the pilot is on board, there is a pilot card available. So make sure you take the pilot through the pilot card. He may have boarded the vessel many times, but it is your duty to take the pilot through the pilot card. You can mention it in the logbook as well. Once he's done, get his signature with the familiarity on the ISM checklist. And cover the legal basis as well to ensure that you have done your job. You have advised the pilot of all the special circumstances or normal circumstances that a pilot will experience through the transit of the vessel in the pilotage channel. The next question is, if you're on watch at night, how would you know that the visibility was deteriorating? So you, of course, during the daytime, you can observe through sight that your visibility is did not your visibility, but the visibility in general is deteriorating. But during night, it becomes a bit tricky sometimes to understand whether the visibility is deteriorating or not, especially if there are not many ships around. So how can you understand that the visibility is deteriorating? It's becoming worse. You observe the backscattering of the navigation lights, especially the masthead light. If you see the masthead light, you can see a bit of a backscattering. You can see a bit of a haze around the navigation light, and that haze, that misting effect, kind of indicates that the visibility must be deteriorating. And the visible range being established from the radar observation of a target as and when it becomes visible to the naked eye. So start observing the radar, start looking out for any land-based objects. It could be fixed objects like recons or buoys or a vessel that is there in the area. So start comparing when you can see it on the radar to the point when you can see it with your own eyes. So that gives you a good idea about the visibility around you and whether it's deteriorating or it's still the same. The third question is, if you're approaching a pilot station to take the pilot, you're sent down below to meet the pilot on deck at the ladder position. What actions would you take when you are at the ladder position? So this is a very important job. Although many ship's officers don't realize it, this is a very important job to pick up the pilot, and because the safety of the pilot rests with you as the responsible officer. So as a responsible officer, make sure you inspect the rigging of the ladder, especially the deck securing hitches of the ladder to rope tails. So try to tie a safety belt around you and around a ship structure, and then test the pilot ladder by stepping on the pilot ladder or climbing a couple of steps. But always make sure that you are safe as well, because if the pilot ladder is not rigged safely and you are testing it out before the pilot comes, there is a possibility that even you can face an accident, fall down, or get yourself injured. So make sure that you are always safe. There is somewhere around, say, someone who is around you, and you have tied a safety belt before you are stepping onto the ladder to test the load of the ladder. Then make sure that you ensure that the stanchions, man ropes are all correctly rigged. So the stanchions are where the pilot ladder will be there. They refer to the iron stanchions I'm talking about. And then the man ropes. The man ropes, many pilots, sometimes they don't like man ropes. That's up to the pilot. But it's your job to make sure that the man ropes are correctly rigged and they are strong enough. They are holding the weight of a person. But if the pilot doesn't want the man ropes, then you can remove it. The pilot station would expect to have a heaving line and a live buoy ready and available, and you should make sure that it is there. So sometimes the live buoy and heaving line, not sometimes, but it should always be there. This is for those cases when a pilot might fall into the water, and this is for additional safety. You must anticipate that the standby man would also be on station, and the immediate deck area was safe and clear of obstructions. So there should be a couple of seamen always available there to assist as required. If all was in order, you report to the bridge using the two-way radio or the VHF walkie-talkie, and your presence at the ladder station, and that all was ready to receive the pilot on board. So make sure once you check all the arrangements, you should report back to the master on the bridge or a senior officer on the bridge that you have checked the pilot ladder and you are ready to receive the pilot on board. And that indicates to the pilot that yes, a responsible officer has checked the ladder, the arrangements, because this is quite a dangerous operation if you think about it. Sometimes boarding the pilot ladder can be very dangerous, especially if the seas are rough, vessel is pitching or rolling. So make sure that the safety arrangements have been checked by you as a responsible officer. So make sure you report again to the bridge when the pilot is on the ladder and when the pilot has boarded the vessel safely. Make sure that the pilot entry may be obtained via shell door in some cases, and access procedures may be changed to suit the opening and closing of the door. Fourth question is, when the vessel is at anchor, what would you consider as the main function of the officer on watch? So when conducting an anchor watch, the ship is still considered being at sea. As such, the primary duty of the officer on watch is to maintain an effective lookout by all available means, including visible, audible, and radar. Neither would you allow the vessel to stand into danger, and would check the position at regular intervals to ensure that the ship was not dragging her anchor. Position monitoring while at anchor would entail checking by primary and secondary position fixing methods, that is checking visual anchor bearings, radar range and bearings, GPS, and optional transit marks if obtainable. While at anchor, the officer on watch should monitor the state of visibility as well, the state of the weather, especially the wind and tide changes, the traffic movement in and out of the anchorage. Navigational signals should be checked continuously that they are visible and lights are correctly functioning. Access to the ship would also be of concern, and the International Ship and Port Security Code, which is the ISP8 code, should be implemented. The very high frequency or VHF radio should be monitored throughout for communication traffic, and logbooks should be maintained and the master kept informed of anything untoward. Why this is very important for you guys is when ship's officers are in anchor watch, they kind of assume that they can lower the guard because the ship is not moving, the ship is stationary, and everything is relatively safer. Do not make such assumptions, because it's quite possible that your ship may start to drag anchor and you may be unaware, and then you drag anchor, and you that leads you into going and hitting another vessel, or another vessel may start dragging anchor come and hit you. In any case, the blame will also come on the ship's officer, who has not been keeping a good lookout. So always ensure that there's a good lookout. Changes in weather conditions sometimes may indicate that your own vessel may start dragging anchor. So you have to make sure that the anchor is holding. Use different position fixing methods, as many as you can, to ensure that your vessel is holding anchor. Safety of the vessel also becomes important. Sometimes you are at anchorage in high piracy prone areas or high theft areas. So you must ensure that the your staff or ship's crew is always available to, they are taking deck patrols and they are alert. And at the same time, they are safe. So there should always be 2 to 3 people who are keeping a watch on deck. If it's not safe to keep watch on deck, they should be keeping a watch from the ship's bridge to ensure that nobody, no thieves or no pirates are boarding the vessel. All right. Position fixing also is very important. Although you may assume that the ship is standing still or rather anchored and not moving, so you must be holding a position. That's a wrong assumption to make. Many a times I have faced situations where the ship has started to drag anchor and it drags slowly. And before you know it, it could get very dangerous. The last question for today is, while on watch during a coastal passage, you sight a vessel aground on a bearing of approximately 1 point off the port bow. What action would you be taking? So as the officer on watch, you place the engines on standby and the situation may make it necessary to take all the way off your own ship. So that would mean that if you see a vessel aground on the, say on your port bow, especially when you are not expecting a vessel to be aground in that area. Maybe you are transiting an area where you see that the depths are absolutely fine for navigation and suddenly you see a vessel aground. Or you are transiting an area of low depths, but you think that this is good enough for your vessel to transit through and you see a vessel aground. This indicates that maybe there are some areas uncharted in this area. Maybe the depths that are being shown on the chart or on your electronic position fixing plotting method, electronic chart plotter is incorrect. Maybe the ECDIS is not updated. Maybe that area has had some recent incident which has not been notified. So seeing a vessel aground should immediately ring the bells in your head. And you should, ideally, the steps they say is that inform the master and completely turn your vessel 180 degrees. And then keep the vessel 180 degrees on the opposite course unless and until the master comes on board, or rather comes on the bridge, and then he or she decides what to take. So your subsequent actions should include advising the master of the situation of the vessel aground, carrying out a chart assessment to include your own ship's position and the position of the vessel aground. Like I said before, make sure that you are not into any kind of uncharted depths, or you are not into areas where the information on the chart may be incorrect. Switch on the echo sounder and start noting down the undercreek clearance to ensure that you have sufficient depth to transit that area. Start to post lookouts and turn autopilot from automatic to manual. So start manual steering of the vessel. Communicate with the vessel aground with this station identification, obtaining the draft of the aground vessel and the time of grounding. Carry out an assessment of the extent of the shoal that the vessel has run aground on. Note that once the master is present on the bridge, it would be normal practice for the master to take the con, assume the steering, but he or she would expect an equally detailed report from the officer on watch. So when you're the officer on watch, make sure that as soon as you see a vessel aground, you should turn the vessel around by 180 degrees, inform the master, and start making an assessment of why the vessel may have gone aground. Sometimes it's possible to contact the aground vessel. Sometimes it's not. If you can contact the aground vessel, that would be great. You can get the information of the aground vessel. Sometimes there are safety messages which are being broadcasted, and that is the reason I always used to tell my officers that you should be monitoring safety equipment like navtechs or weather bulletins, and make sure that you monitor these, because sometimes the information may have just come in, and when you monitor these stations and you get the information, you make sure that you plot this information on the charts. And then if you are unable to contact the vessel aground, then you have to wait for the master and his or her experience to take over the con, of course, and try to get the information from the, if there is any nearby shore station, any reporting vessel reporting system, so on and so forth. All right. So that pretty much covers the questions for today. This is part 2. I'll see you soon with part 3 and the subsequent series. If you have any feedback to give me, I'll be very happy to receive it. Thanks, guys, and all the best with your studies. I'll see you soon.